Hello, and a very happy new year to you all. Welcome back to tonight's book reading of Preparing for the Day After, a picture e-book. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight, we will learn about the impact of the Asian tsunami on biological and zoological diversity. It is part 1 of chapter 16. Next week, I should be able to wrap up this chapter on bio and the impact of the tsunami on bio and zoological diversity. Let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading session before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation are central to developmental discourse. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal health care access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the developmental agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting on disaster preparedness or the lack of it at district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Now let us start with the chapter on the impact of the tsunami on biological and zoological diversity in tonight's reading. The impact of the big geological events like the mega earthquake that triggered the Asian tsunami impounds and imperils wildlife and the environment. The consequences of such a massive impact are felt on us and our livelihood. In the Japanese Sendai Tohoku mega earthquake too, the mega tsunami impaired biological and zoological diversity in the far off coasts around the Pacific Rim. But our comprehension and thereby preparedness can mitigate disasters in the future, possibly for all creatures. So let us understand the impact of the geological aspects logically. All calamities impair wildlife and native biodiversity, be they avalanches, blizzards, cloudbursts, coastal incursions, cyclones, droughts, desertification, El Nino Southern Oscillation, epidemics, earthquakes, floods, flash floods, famine, forest fire, fog, hailstorms, hurricanes, landslides, mudslides, storm surge, storms, squalls, thunderstorms, tsunamis, urban floods, or volcanoes. That is because habitat and ecosystems of the native wildlife are destroyed. When calamities strike, habitat is altered in various ways. When the habitat is destroyed, fauna are separated. This causes isolation of genetic pool in the short run as well as in the long term. This leads to inbreeding and weakening of a species, potentially destroying faunal populations. Biodiversity, on the other hand, may be impaired due to cross-pollination by invasive species and can lead to genetic mutation of biodiversity. This affects both faunal and biodiverse wealth. However, seasons can nullify the after effects of the calamities in the long term. But if climate change becomes a cog in the distorted wheel, the whole cycle of seasons go awry and then it becomes virtually impossible to quantify or forecast. Avalanche can create flash floods and destroy the native bio and zoo diversity, besides impairing livelihoods and livestock. Blizzards usher cold winds and cold wave, impairing agriculture, lives of vulnerable populations, and food security of the weak and marginalized. Cloudbursts are torrential rains in a short span of time and hammer the landscape, pummeling into agri, bio, and zoo diversity, impairing lives, livelihoods, and livestock. Coastal incursion accounts for habitat destruction in one of the most sensitive ecosystems, coastal belts, where highly vulnerable wildlife call it their home. Cyclones affect the livelihoods and food security of one of the most vulnerable populations, fisher folk. That impairs food security of those who buy fish too. droughts, it seems, appear and occur in cyclical fashion. But tropical countries like South Asian countries and the countries around the Indian Ocean rim are very vulnerable to drought and its impact on the agricultural produce. Food security, food inflation, tax infrastructure, agricultural trade, international relations, balance of power, and according to some intellectuals, even the modern day scourge, terrorism, is rooted in economic despair in an unfair world order. Desertification is the process of the groundwater table being rendered dry thanks wholly to anthropogenic pressure. Desertification causes drought and leads to a whole gamut of issues dealt with heretofore. Cloudburst. The Himalayan tsunami in Uttarakhand in June 2013, for example, was partly a man-made disaster, said experts. The man-made disaster, part of the calamity, included the impacts of illegal tenements and structures, adding to the flash flood fury. Flash floods, floods, famine, forest fire, and fog are all the corollary of drought and desertification, all emanating from moisture stress in the extremes. Quote, "It is impossible to convey the enormity of this tsunami event. Satellite imagery begins to convey the scale of the impact. Before and after images show the significant changes to base physical landscape characteristics. Site photos only begin to convey the immediate effects on the ground. The scale of the phenomena is a challenge both in terms of making general comments equally applicable across the affected region and in extrapolating the results from the limited environmentally focused assessments initiated so far," unquote, says the UNEP report called After the Tsunami Rapid Environmental Assessment, the link of which is going to be put up in the description box below. Disaster mitigation efforts like soil conservation, rainwater harvesting, watershed management, conservation of native biodiversity will lessen the impact of calamities on environments, can mitigate the impact of many a hydrometeorological calamity. Avalanches, blizzards, cloudbursts, coastal incursions, cyclones, droughts, desertification, epidemics, El Nino Southern Oscillation and its various impacts, floods, flash floods, famine, forest fire, fog, hailstorms, landslides, mudslides, storm surge, storms, squalls, thunderstorms in the long term. Quote, "Of these, El Nino Southern Oscillation is a hydrogeological calamity. The rest are hydrometeorological disasters," says Dr. B. N. Goswami, retired director of the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology in Pune, in an exclusive email interview given to me for this book. The mega earthquake was caused by plate subduction, and the Andaman Sumatra earthquake of magnitude 9.3 heaved up land in places farther from the epicenter, at least in Andaman Nicobar Islands in India. But nearer to the epicenter, the lands subsided. Habitat changed in response to upheaval or subduction. Some islands, like the Megapod Island in Nicobar District, collapsed into the sea. Shoal ecosystems have been enriched in other places like northeast of Hutt Bay, Little Andaman between North and South Brother Islands. In other places where the subterranean compression of gas chambers, beziehungsweise release of gases, hot springs, water spouts, aftershocks, natural gas emissions and geysers, co-seismic activity can prompt development of fissures, sinkholes, eruption of sand or mud volcanoes, and of course the dreaded tsunami. Volcanoes can erupt too. In fact, the subterranean movement or slip of magma under the lithosphere can nurture fresh new volcanic sites. Some of these forces can enrich soil fertility and thereby biological and zoological diversity in the long term. A mud volcano or a sand volcano, on the other hand, can destroy the fertility of the landscape and thereby the floral and faunal wealth too. You see pictures of the mud volcano in Barathang in Andaman there. Bathymetric profile changes because of upheaval, which can change the course of currents, wind speeds and directions, monsoons, rainfall, snowfall, precipitation and microclimate of a region. This affects migration patterns of marine wildlife, birds, corals, fish, terrestrial fauna, insects, pollination, food availability and the birth rate and death rate of all creatures, great and small. This can impact microclimate in a region or a hemisphere, for the short as well as for the long term. Disaster preparedness for hydrometeorological and hydrogeological calamities starts with early warning. for accurate early warning and administrative cohesion, effective geospatial planning and land use mapping go a long way in disaster mitigation, mitigating the impact of calamities in a unit of land use. Similarly, bathymetric profile is essential to forecast not just the path of a cyclone, but also of a tsunami or behavior of sea mounds. Now you see why climate change is a concentric geological cyclical phenomenon. Each one of these after effects can affect the local biota, which in turn can affect the nesting and breeding factors of endemic wildlife both on land and under sea. Even if the Asian tsunami affected the microclimate of the subcontinent and the Indian Ocean Rim countries in the near term, it can affect agro, bio and zoological diversity in the long term. Professor C.P. Rajendran of the Center for Earth Science Studies in Trivandrum told me in an exclusive discussion on the 4th of October 2012, and I quote, "Seismic phenomena are spatially and temporally on different scales," unquote. Eustatic sea level changes have global impact on sea level. In Andaman and Nicobar Islands in India, in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, the Andaman Islands north of the 10 degrees channel heaved up, whereas the Nicobar Islands, also called the southern group of islands, subsided or collapsed or subducted into the sea. A number of aftershocks of the mega earthquake triggered an earthquake swarm around a number of Nicobar Islands, all of which created local tsunamis and had geological after effects. For example, the Trinket Island in Middle Nicobar, or the Nankauri group of islands, got trifurcated. Seawater inundation caused habitat loss to endemic creatures and also triggered invasive species of fish, vectors and pests. Little Andaman Island or Hut Bay, the southernmost of the Andaman group of islands, has seen an increase in the number of estuarine crocodiles. Partly the reason for this is relocation of some troublesome man-eating crocodiles, but relocated crocodiles only account for less than half a dozen estuarine crocodiles. Impact on vulnerable wildlife. Many of the southern Nicobar group of islands like Megapod Islands and parts of Campbell Bay subsided or collapsed into the sea. The ensuing tsunami coppiced tree plantations and inundated large tracts of habitations. Arboreal creatures like birds, reptiles, squirrels perished instantly. That has affected food chain. The ground nesting megapod was severely affected because of lack of habitat. Its native habitat in Megapod Island was lost to the tsunami. In fact, the Megapod Island subducted completely. It vanished. It has been because there is this sea level rise because of the tectonic activity. It has risen and it will at some point subside again. But then as of now, the Megapod Island has disappeared. The small island of Megapod Island completely collapsed into the sea during the Asian tsunami, thus eradicating from the face of the earth the only natural and native habitat for the ground nesting megapod listed as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List. It is cause enough to upgrade its status from vulnerable to endangered because of the drastic fall in numbers following the Asian tsunami, avers Dr. K. Shivakumar, wildlife scientist from India's Wildlife Institute of India. Quote, "The small isolated populations of the Nicobar megapod called the Megapodius nicobarensis, currently categorized as vulnerable on the IUCN Red List on the Nicobar Islands in the Indian Ocean, have declined by circa 70% since 1994. The 2004 tsunami is believed to be the major cause of this decline. The populations of megapods on the islands of the megapod and tracts were wiped out by the tsunami. I estimate from the 2006 survey that 395 to 790 breeding pairs of the Nicobar megapod now survive on the coast of the various islands, compared to 2,318 to 4,056 pairs in 1994. The tsunami also adversely influenced nest site selection and mound nest ecology. More than 50% of mounds were found closer to the shore in 2006 than in 1994. Probably because of loss of suitable habitat, and they may become inundated with seawater during high tides. Most of the mound nests found were constructed after the tsunami and were significantly smaller in volume than those present in 1994. Restoration of suitable habitat is critical for the long-term viability of the Nicobar megapod. However, post-tsunami impacts such as the creation of large-scale plantations in coastal areas which are encroaching upon megapod habitat may be severe. Because of the decline in numbers and habitat destruction and hunting, the Nicobar megapod probably now qualifies for categorization as endangered on the IUCN Red List, says Dr. Kshiv Kumar, wildlife scientist of the Wildlife Institute of India, in an article called Impact of Tsunami on Nicobar Megapod, published by Oryx in January 2010. The link of this has been put up in the description box below the video. However, Mohan Barek, the caretaker of the APWD Inspection Bungalow in Campbell Bay in Great Nicobar Island and resident of the Great Nicobar Island, told me in an exclusive interview, quote, "Though megapods have suffered loss of habitat after the tsunami, they can easily be seen in the jungles in and around Campbell Bay beyond the habitations," unquote. Domesticated livestock became feral. Kimius is the 34-year-old eldest son of Mr. Sitaram, the most famous Nicobarese face who worked in the Andaman Adi Janjati Vikas Sangathan or Samiti. Mr. Sitaram has, after retirement, settled in Campbell Bay. He's since, after my interview in 2014, he passed away, I'm told. Their traditional home near Indira Point was washed out by the tsunami, and hence they have been resettled in Rajiv Nagar, a new township in the equatorial rainforest in Campbell Bay. He says, "But we Nicobarees love the sea. We have created our own temporary shelters on the beach so we can spend daytime near the sea," said Kimius. To me, during a discussion, personal discussion there, he was reiterating at the same time that they have got from the government of India full compensation package and a built house in Rajiv Nagar, about 5 kilometers inland. Kimius and his family ran pell-mell towards the higher hills as the tsunami waves started gushing to the shore. Minutes after the tsunami, Kimius's livestock, including pigs, sheep, goats and cattle, started running inland, intuitively sensing danger. "Now they have become feral and no longer respond to our calls," Kimius told me in an exclusive discussion on the 8th of March 2014 in Great Nicobar Island. "Domesticated cattle have become feral and thus an invasive species in an island ecosystem where wildlife scientists cry themselves hoarse that invasives have to be culled." Mohan Barek also added that the Magar Nalla, literally translates to Crocodile Creek, was not part of the landscape before the tsunami. "During the Asian tsunami, sea invaded this stretch of the human colony and coconut plantation called Old Fisherman's Colony, which has become the home of estuarine crocodiles in the post-tsunami era. Although most islanders and officials say that estuarine crocodiles are visible only in Great Nicobar Island or Campbell Bay, one official, Mr. Krishnamurthy of the Andaman Lakshadweep Harbour Works, confirmed to me that in 1991 he had sighted an estuarine crocodile in Tilanchong." That's another island somewhere near the Middle Nicobar Islands. "In a paper titled Status of Long-tailed Macaques and Conservation of the Recovery Population in Great Nicobar Island, Indian zoologist Drs. K. Narasimha Rajan and Dr. C. Raghunathan of the Zoological Survey of India Andaman Nicobar Regional Center have assessed the recovery of the long-tailed macaque, also called Nicobari macaque. Quote, "We assess the present status and population abundance of long-tailed macaque in Great Nicobar Island, India, from November 2011 to February 2012. A total of 34 groups comprising 1,133 monkeys were sighted, with the group sizes varying from 8 to 127 individuals, the mean numbers being 33.32 plus or minus 4.82. We compared them with previously published reports from 2003 to 2006. However, there were no significant changes between the group sighted in the forest areas located in the interior regions of the island, where N equals 13 and 0.12 groups per kilometer, while a significant increase was noticed in the number of groups sighted in the coastal forest regions of the island, where N equals 0.19 groups per kilometer. The survey results revealed that after the tsunami, the coastal population is slowly recovering. The adult sex ratio, that is male and female, and the adult immature ratio was 1 is to 2.14 and 1 is to 1, respectively, indicating a healthy population. Therefore, several monkey groups were seen in the abundant coconut farms near the coastal region, which were planted by islanders who lived there before the tsunami. Comprehensive human-monkey conflict was observed in the interior regions of the islands, where monkeys destroyed the coconut and cultivation farms, while dogs were used to control the monkey menace. Improving farm management and providing adequate compensation schemes are critical for successfully implementing such conservation efforts," unquote. The link of this publication has been put up in the description box below. In another similar study titled Impact of the Tsunami in December 2004 on the long-tailed macaque on Nicobar Islands, India, Kupuswamy Shivakumar of the Wildlife Institute of India says, "We carried out a standard survey to assess the distribution and abundance of Macaca fascicularis umbrosa of Nicobar Islands, India, after the tsunami, which washed the whole region in 2004, and compared them with those reported for 2000. A total of 40 groups comprising 814 monkeys were cited, group size varying from 7 to 98 animals, with a mean average of 20.35 plus or minus 1.82. There was no significant change in the number of groups sighted in the interior parts of the islands before and after the tsunami. Also, the adults or juveniles ratio in the group varied from 1:1 to 1:0.4. A fairly low ratio of immatures to adult females suggests that the tsunami also affected the population structure of the monkeys. The destruction of major coastal fruit trees exploited by monkeys might be the reason for their lower presence in coastal areas. Future restoration of fruit plantations could enhance the human-wildlife conflict. It is a significant conservation recommendation, but enlisted very low in the priority of an anthropocentric tsunami recovery in the thin island mass. It's a peril at the cost of future human-wildlife conflict. WHO and UNICEF undertook fumigation on a massive scale to prevent the spread of vector-borne diseases that could arise from overstressed sanitation systems in relief shelters, both in Andaman Nicobar Islands and the tsunami-battered coast of Tamil Nadu in India. In the tsunami-battered coastal districts of Cuddalore and Nagapattinam in Tamil Nadu, India, fisher folk whine that fish catch has dwindled in the decades since the tsunami. Fishing grounds have gone farther from the coast because of change in coastal landscapes. Many a mouth of rivulet or creek has become farther to reach after the tsunami. Coupled with increase in fuel prices, repeated and frequent cyclone damage and depleting fish catch, fishing is no longer cost effective for us. Fisherfolk, says Malai Arasan in MGR Thittu New Settlement in Cuddalore District in Tamil Nadu in an exclusive discussion with me. Marine fauna like corals, fishes, cetaceans were displaced because of alteration in the bathymetric profile. UNEP impact assessment report suggested that marine wildlife like corals may have been injured by crashing submarine boulders and waves. The high-speed tsunami waves, whose undercurrents were equally fierce, could possibly have choked creatures like sea turtles. It would also most certainly have affected the survival of creatures like cetaceans. Fish breeding, resting sites, and the corals, of course, were damaged. Off the coast of Havelock Island in the Andaman district in Andaman Nicobar Islands, the uplift of the ocean floor exposed the coral to the sun and they died en masse. That photograph is there somewhere. It'll come. One of the direct correlations of the El Nino of 2009-2010 and near-term microclimate change post-tsunami has been coral bleaching in the Andaman Sea. Publishing the article called Bleaching, the Driving Force of Scleractinian New Recruitment at Little Andaman Island, Andaman Nicobar Islands in Springer, the final publication is available at a particular link which is going to be put up in the description box below. Authors Dr. Tamal Mondal, Dr. C. Raghunathan and Dr. K. Venkata Raman say, "Massive habitat, massive destruction was encountered in 2004 tsunami in coral reefs as the entire marine habitat was changed due to the presence of mud, sand, debris and pollutants, etc. In marine waters from nearby coastal areas on the other side, massive bleaching in Andaman Sea during the 2010 El Nino was documented only for the rise of the SST, that is sea surface temperature, from its normal average ranges. The bleaching is obviously a destructive phenomenon which damaged entire coral reef areas of Andaman Nicobar Island, mostly up to the depth of 15 meters. The bleached corals were transformed mostly into dead ones, but very few survived with a sense of replenishment of resilience against the climatic changes. The continental shelf of Little Andaman Island, the southernmost part of the Andaman group of islands, showed a limited number of scleractinian corals as the new recruitment at the destroyed reef areas after the 2004 tsunami. The presence of species composition of the study area is near about 4 times higher than the study which was made on newly recruited corals after the tsunami. Bleaching was the only giant event which occurred in between 2009 and 12, considered as the prime regulator for the new recruitment of scleractinians. The Shannon Weaver Species Diversity Index of the study area ranges from 5.09 to 6. Simpson Species Density Index varies from 0.94 to 0.97, whereas the Pileus Evenness Index shows the results in between 0.93 and 0.98. The present paper depicts the species composition, diversity, density and evenness at post-bleaching state to signify the constructive role of bleaching towards the settlement of new scleractinian coral life on the preceding places. Global warming produces significant increase in the frequency of high sea surface temperature. The life and death process has been going on in a dynamic motion among the scleractinian corals. Death and destruction was also expedited with several natural calamities. New recruitment of a few corals was observed at the Little Andaman Island after the Asian tsunami, one of the giant destructors. Tsunami damage did not suppress recruitment in smashed sites relative to no impacted controls. Coral reefs that have been undermined can lose their ability to adapt and regenerate. Bleaching is a physiological process which can be described as one of the adaptive features by means of regulation and stress response. Coppiced coconut plantations in Nicobar Islands are being reclaimed by Mother Nature thanks to inviolate isolation. Rewilding has created an ecological succession of biota in the tropical islands, both terrestrially and in the ocean. With biological and ecological rewilding comes the corresponding faunal spectrum, including insects, birds, reptiles, pelagic fauna, mammals, including feral livestock, and so on. Yes, you get a picture of the rewilding taking place in abandoned places in the islands where the tsunami annihilated civilization. It's coming. There are coppiced coconut plantations I've taken close-ups of. Trinket Island got trifurcated by seawater inundation in the Asian tsunami. This had a massive impact on turtle nesting sites as well as the population of sea turtles. Forest officials I spoke to in Port Blair alluded to loss of turtle nesting sites because of the tsunami. The marine turtles have a reputation for crossing oceans, especially the ones who are radio collared tags. They are known to be migrating from areas in the Pacific Ocean to areas in the Southern Indian Ocean or even the Northern Indian Ocean for nesting. They come here to lay their eggs in spots where they were born. But this, I discovered the track of a turtle in Car Nicobar's Kakana Beach on the 11th of January 2007. This was despite the claims of the forest officials. I was very amused I could see a turtle track right next to me early in the morning at 7 o'clock on a beach, in the Air Force Beach. It appeared that inadequate research and assessment had been undertaken regarding damage to turtle nesting sites in the post-tsunami era. However, by January 2007, the forest officials had woken up and were intensely patrolling beaches known for turtle nesting. Turtle nesting sites like Ramnagar Beach and Kirtpur Bay in North Andaman were patrolled by forest guards, and once the guards noticed a turtle laying egg, they would protect the site from predators and scavengers like birds of prey, jackals and dogs, till the mother turtle returned to the sea. Then they would collect the eggs and nurture them in cane nests in a sandy cover in the beach that was protected by a compound wall. So it's a turtle nursery there. They create a turtle nursery. Ross Island and Kalipur Bay are the new turtle nesting sites in Andaman Islands post the tsunami, when the islands have tilted on an east-west orientation, according to Forest Officer Sharavanan. The monthly statistics of the Forest Department suggests this, the officer said. The fact that the Nicobar group of islands or the southern group of islands have subsided into the sea while the Andamans have heaved up substantiate the theory of new nesting sites in the North Andaman district. I chose to volunteer for one night at the Ramnagar Beach in North Andaman on the moonless new moon night on the 18th of January 2007, inviting amused derision by my friends in the capital, Port Blair. You have chosen a very good time to go volunteer on a moonless, dark moonless night, Malini, they teased me. As luck would have it, no mother turtle was found laying eggs despite guards patrolling on the left and on the right for hours on end on a moonless but starry night. But a good 105 hatchlings broke their shells to come alive into this fascinating but sometimes cruel world. For an unedited version of my first-hand experience volunteering in Ramnagar Beach and Kirtpur Bay, please do feel free to read one of my articles on this link. I'll try to put it up here as well, but it is there in the description box below. Another similar article was published in Statesman. However, to my luck, that day, it was not published in the online edition. Hence, I have copied the raw, unedited version of the article published in Statesman for your benefit here below in a box item, which I will now read to you. Midnight Encounter with Olive Ridley's. It was only in the Andaman Nicobar Islands that I truly appreciated the beauty of the new moonlight for the first time in my life. It was a starlit night, a whole curtain of diamonds dripping across the moonless sky. I was on a mission to track the endangered Olive Ridley turtles as they came ashore to lay their eggs. I went out to check on the nesting sites and hatchlings in the Ramnagar Bay on the new moonlight night. On reaching the sand cliff, I was told to alight from the jeep as we had reached the beach. But pray, where? I could not see anything. As the headlights of the jeep were turned off and my eyes got used to the darkness around me, I finally summoned the guts to get out of the jeep barefoot and sink my toes in the sands. After a couple of minutes, I could make out the faint outline of white foam of the waves at a distance. The noise of the breaking waves alerted me to the fact that the sea was indeed very close. As one wave grew louder than the previous one, I found the solace which had been eluding me the past 3 weeks. I mean, this was January 2007. I left Bangalore on the 31st of December night, and that was the day Iraqi leader Saddam Hussein had been executed. So I was very disturbed, you can imagine. He was a dictator and his circumstances of his trial were questionable, etc. But it was a televised execution, oh heavens. I was so disturbed and I couldn't even see it. Obviously I couldn't see it, but I was extremely disturbed. So this was the kind of peace that I was seeking, and it really calmed my soul when I went up to the beach that night. I found the solace which had been eluding me the past 3 weeks. The waves at high tide were around 10 feet away from my feet. I quietly gathered my thoughts to commune with Mother Nature. Oh Mother, abide with me. Fast falls the even tide. The darkness deepens. Lord, with me abide. I couldn't help but wonder how the wondrous sea could be so callous to send out gigantic waves that destroyed everything in their path. Nature leaves you wondering. Every once in a while, I would see flickering diamonds across the sky from south-southeasterly direction. They were moving real fast for shooting stars, I thought. I called out to the Divisional Forest Officer, Mr. Saravanan, who was with us, to exclaim how lucky we were to sight so many shooting stars. I was told rather plainly that they were the flickering lights from Boeing 747s, which are flying from either Bangkok or Singapore towards Europe. That was a fallback to harsh reality, believe me. The wildlife camp officer's night patrol approached us and was eager to share with me the news that they had so far sighted 93 Olive Ridley turtles in Ramnagar Beach this season, beginning October 2006 and expected to last until the first week of April 2007. Around 243 eggs had been counted and were kept in safe custody at the hatchery at Ramnagar. On sighting the turtles, they quietly followed the mother Ridleys. Once they see the turtle settling into the pocket of sand, the officers watch keenly for any handicap or maimed limbs. If they spot a maimed mother, they actually assist in pushing the sand or in digging pits. The fisher folk are insensate and callous towards the turtles caught in their nets. Instead of separating them from the fish in the nets, they callously cut off their limbs that are ensconced in the net and let them fall into the sea. This affects their swimming abilities, no doubt, but as nature's rules say, their progenation abilities are not affected by torn limbs. They leave the ocean secrets in genetic code on the seashores, but these handicapped turtles find it very difficult to dig the pits in the sand. That is a crucial gap which conservationists help in. Once the mother lays the eggs and returns to the sea, the patrol party covers the fresh eggs in a bushel of sand to protect them from the predators, and then they go searching for more. At daybreak, they bring the eggs into the hatchling nursery and place them in sand pits covered in circular, bottomless cane baskets that lack sunshades. Details of date, time, and number are recorded on a wooden stick. 55 days later, the officers watch out for the hatchlings. On hatching, they are typically a restive lot. One search party informed the DFO that they could not find any mother turtles that night, that is on the 18th of January 2007, but the hatchlings are breaking out of the eggshells in the nursery, they said. In one basket, we counted 105 hatchlings and carefully took them out of the cane baskets to place in a carton to take them seaward. In another basket too, I noticed a hatchling was kind of stuck in the mud, or rather in the sand. The birth pangs are so important for the survival mechanism of all creatures, great and small. At that moment, however, I was a bit excited and told the forest guards that one hatchling seems to be either stillborn or is struggling. The guards then took great care to dig in the sands around the eggshell from which it was emerging. After the assistant digging, it emerged, but I fear it was deprived of the birth pangs. I sincerely hope I did not do it a great disservice by depriving it of the struggle for birth. We took with us 100 restless baby turtles in the carton towards the sea. The DFO, that is the Divisional Forest Officer, Mr. Saravanan, kept aside 5 of the hatchlings in a big bottle filled with seawater for demonstration to the visiting probationary officers who were expected the next day. Once we reached the wet sands, we started placing them by delicately removing them from the carton. Instinctively, they started crawling towards the sea. Selfish human beings that we are, we could not resist the temptation of flashing the torches to see their progress towards the sea. The moment we turned the flashlights on, they turned back towards the light. We would immediately switch off and they would head back to the sea. I was the worst opportunist here. I actually did flash photography. But I couldn't see. I mean, you can't do photography of a turtle nesting site or the turtles going to the sea without flash, that too in the dead of a moonless night. So when I did this flash photography, wondering about its effect only later. The hatchlings were utterly disoriented by trying to head back towards the source of light instead of the sea. They would get confused, you know, they use the stars as navigation. And if I put on either my flashlight or my torchlight, they get disoriented. And that's very opportunistic on the part of human beings. I did it because I'm in the media, but it's nevertheless not very justified. In a matter of 12 to 15 minutes, they all had entered the sea. The moment they were engulfed by the waves was a moment of emotion, moving us to bequeath our possessive feelings. It was the connection to Mother Nature that I was seeking. At least we ensured safe passage to their home. But their real struggle for survival starts at that precise moment when they set their gingerly feet or nose into the lashing sea. Still eager to search for the elusive mother turtle, I decided to head towards another known turtle nesting site, the Kurt Burt Bay. Turtle nesting sites in the Great Nicobar Island were washed away in the tsunami, according to forest officials. After a 5-hour jeep ride with the DCF on the truncated Andaman Trunk Road, from Diglipur to Mayabandar and then to Kurt Burt Bay, I finally reached the turtle sanctuary at 11 p.m. the next night. I was so exhausted that I had made up my mind to call off one more night of watch and vigil. I was feeling jet-lagged after waking up at 4 a.m. for 5 days continuously. But this was indeed the most magical of moments. Getting into a fiberglass boat at a high tide in a creek that heads out to sea sounded promising. But the blessed boat had no flashlight. The one guard who had the flashlight was more interested in showing me the mangrove forest around the creek than focusing it ahead. The nervous boatman would scream at the guard, "Aage maro!" Imagine going out into the sea on a boat without a headlight when the tide is high. What if we hit a rock or even an island or overhanging a tree branch? Or, like I later discovered in Sri Lanka, I was taken steered by the boatman right under a mangrove tree branch, and just 2 feet away from here was a snake, the green vine snake. I think that photograph just came in somewhere there. Or hold your breath, what if we bump into a nursing estuarine crocodile in the mangrove creek, na? We finally touched the seashore where we had to get off the boat without a pyre and started trekking up to the nursery deep inside the Casuarina Grove. It was a 20-minute walk in pitch dark surroundings. To feel Mother Earth, I risked walking barefoot on the cluttered by nature beach. Leaf litter and shrubs, uprooted tree roots and small rocks were all strewn on the paths to the nursery. The high tide was rambunctious and scary. None of the eggs were hatching tonight, so we had to sit in the golgar or the thatched roof dining hall area, barely 7 meters from the high tide line, and we discussed the horror of the tsunami. This is the area where, you know, lunch is usually served, but this was middle of the night, so we didn't expect lunch or dinner, but this was a PR area, so to say, for the forest officials. The camp officers of the turtle sanctuary told me that they had counted 243 turtles in 5 weeks, starting from the 10th of December 2006, and had counted 1,254 eggs. I kept looking out to the sea in panic. It was time to head back to the hinterland before the tide went too far down. But by the time we came back to the parked boat, the tide was indeed low, and it was a tricky affair to climb down into the boat. It used to get stuck in the mud flats. It was getting stuck in the mud flats. The tide was so low now that it was another ceremony to climb back from the boat to the bamboo pyre needs no clarification. But it was all's well that ends well, a night to remember. That's all for tonight. The impact of the Asian tsunami on biological and zoological diversity. Tonight we focus only on the impact on India's Andaman Nicobar Islands. Next Saturday, I will be reading up further on the impact of the Asian tsunami on biological and zoological diversity in Indonesia, Seychelles, Sri Lanka, Thailand, etc. I wish you all a very happy New Year 2022. Today is Saturday. We've worked through Christmas. We have not had taken a break at all. Tonight, we will not have a live interaction. Pardon me. I also need a break. I've been working nights and days the past 1.5 months because of the video production also that's going on. Anyway, this exciting times ahead. 2022 is going to be a better year, hopefully. There another 10 weeks or so I should be able to wind up this book. The last chapter on hydrometeorological disasters is very, very interesting. That might take a little longer, so I can't commit exactly. I hope to catch you all during the next week's live interaction and video. That will be the concluding part of this chapter on the impact of the Asian tsunami on biological and zoological diversity. Until then, take care, keep smiling, stay safe, stay home, and ciao. A very happy New Year again.